Looking for a job right now, don't have to tell you that. And whether you're unemployed or just looking for, you know, a change of scenery, it's tough to make yourself stand out among the sea of resumes. Boy,
especially when so many people are unemployed mm-hmm. and a lot of people are unsure why their job hunt is failing, while some other people are getting bites out there. Mary Abajay is here with a look at what you need to know to get your job hunt in gear. Mary, good to see you.
Good to see you guys. How are you?
Good, good.
And just for the record, I haven't watched The Bachelor either.
You haven't either?
I haven't,
ever?
I know.
Okay,
I've
hang on. Ever
it.
Or just this last episode last night?
The last maybe five seasons. I think I saw the first season.
Okay, I've darted around too, but this one, I don't know.
But you know, I'm glad you're watching it because actually dating is very much like looking for a job, right? It is, if you think about it.
Yeah, I guess you have 25 other people vying for that, probably 2,500 people vying for the same spot.
And it's a numbers game, and it's about really like standing out, and it's about making a meaningful connection with your potential employer and not making some classic mistakes.
Just minus the making out.
The other day we had somebody on who was an expert in writing resumes in today's society, and there's a fine line between standing out and standing out too much.
And standing out too much, that's exactly right. You know, and finding... Your resume is the first thing, is another one mistake that people make. Your resume should get you in the door, yet so many people's resumes exclude them and get them just tossed off the pile. It has to be clean. It has to be easily read, right? If you're an HR person, you're looking at hundreds of resumes, are you going to look at the one that's all cluttered or the one that's easy to read? Spell check. I mean, you'd be amazed at how many people still have errors on their resumes. So you're absolutely right. It has got to really work for you and not against
you.
I've
even heard stories of people misspelling their names accidentally.
Oh, they do.
Can you imagine?
And we're so used to spell check, we don't really read anything over. But spell check doesn't get everything, and grammar. So your resume, you're right, Doug. And I would recommend hiring someone to help you with your resume.
You know, I heard that cover letters are kind of out the door because we're sending resumes, you know, via email and things like that. But you say still do a cover letter.
Cover letters are still really, really important. And the thing about cover letters, the big mistake people make with cover letters is they're too general and they're not specific. All right. So when you do a cover letter, see what you can do to find out who it should be sent to. Mm-hmm. To whom it may concern cover letter isn't going to help
you stand out.
Doesn't work.
You know, you mentioned hiring somebody to help you out with the resume. Yeah. So many people have such terrible difficulty writing a legible English sentence nowadays that's going to hurt you if you can't do that.
If you can't do that, that's exactly right. And if know what your weaknesses are in the job search and get help to support you in those weaknesses. Because cover letter and resume are still really important, and they're still the things that block people.
How about picture? A picture.
What's your picture?
You know, I'm of two minds in that. My HR colleagues tell me that sometimes they like that, but sometimes it just looks cheesy, and that's the fine line from making it look good and making it look cheesy.
Going back to the writing of a cover letter, it's so easy these days to be casual and then maybe too casual.
Yeah.
Does it depend on the job, on the lingo you're going to put on the cover letter? Because I always thought formal's the best way to go.
Yeah. I think you should sound approachable, but the purpose of your cover letter is to tell them why you.
Okay.
Why you succinctly are the person for the job. It's not to give, it's not to reiterate your resume, it's not to be overconfident or cocky, it's to be just, I'm the perfect person for this job and here's why. Boom. It shouldn't be very long. Yeah, paragraph, two, tops.
All right. You know, I was about to say biggest mistake, but you want to sound confident, but not cocky.
But not cocky, that's right.
Have you heard of mistakes? Like, give us an example.
Absolutely. Well, for example, in the interviews where people come across as too cocky, and not different from confident, you know, which is another big mistake people make is they're not interviewing well. They're making their mistakes in the interview. And for example, they'll come in and they'll be kind of dismissive of the questions, or they won't really answer the questions because they're so cocky or arrogant, especially young people. You've got to really be like, I can do the job. Here's my skills. Here's my experience. But you don't want to be cocky about it.
You know, I remember my first interview ever, which was to try to get into college that I most wanted to go to. Yeah. And I went to the admissions office. I drove a million miles and showed up there. And I had prepared all this great stuff in my head about me.
Yeah.
And I sat down, nervous as could be, and the interviewer said, well, what do you want to know? And I had nothing to ask.
I hate that question.
And I think it killed me. I didn't get into the college.
Didn't get in.
But conversely, the best interview I ever had was I walked in there and someone told me, if you can get the interviewer to talk about him or herself,
yeah.
And this guy talked for a full hour about himself.
And
about
he loved you, didn't he?
And he loved
and Doug's thinking, I'm in. I better be getting this after an hour, right?
It's so true. People's favorite topics really are themselves. People love to talk about themselves. And so if you can really get a good rapport with the interviewer and get them talking, ask them questions, they will think of you more fondly. I recently had the opportunity to sit with a client while they did third round of interviews, and these are for high-level positions. Uh-huh. I was amazed at some of the common mistakes I saw. People who are over 45 coming into the interview and waiting till the interview begins to turn off their cell phone.
Oh, geez.
I mean, unbelievable. Not answering questions succinctly, rambling, not being dressed appropriately. One person actually took a phone call during the interview. I mean,
really?
It was, and these are people who are professionals and who should know better. So I think we need to tell people to go back to the basics. You know, there are a lot of rules that still apply.
Another thing is editing yourself online. I don't think people think about this.
Clean up your e-life.
You don't have to be a superstar that paparazzi follow and there's pictures out there.
That's right.
We're talking Facebook. Does anybody still use MySpace? Those kinds of things.
You do. You have to really know what's out there. The best way to do that is to simply Google yourself and really go through like 4 or 5 or 6 pages, should you have that many, and look at what's coming up, you know. Check out, make sure your LinkedIn and all that is updated. If there's things you don't like in your e-life that are showing up when you Google yourself.
But you can't edit Google.
No, but you can know what's coming up, so you know what to look for. So let's say you Google yourself and you see what's coming up is a picture of you doing a beer bong on your friend's,
on your friend's Facebook. You may want to call that friend.
Exactly.
And have them take that picture
exactly.
off.
Exactly. And at least you know what they might be seeing. So whether you can do anything about it is one thing. If you can, do so. But at least you can be prepared to answer.
You're ready, rather than say, explain this, Doug McKelway.
Yeah, really. Lucy, we must
talk. Got a lot of explaining to do.
Got a lot of explaining to do.
Exudes self-consciousness. That's one of the tips you have written.
Yeah. Women tend to be a little more self-conscious than men, especially in terms of the resume and the interview. You have to, on the one hand, you want to be confident, not cocky, but you also have to be self-confident. And women tend to undersell themselves in the interview and on the resume. So don't be afraid to say, use strong words on your resume, manage, lead, organize, right? Responsible for. And in the interview, being able to really talk about what you've done well and really be able to key that into past successes, being able to say, here's what I did, here's my success rate, here's what, you know, what I'm really good at. So you have to be able to undersell, you have to be able to sell yourself, not oversell, not undersell, the right amount of sell.
Be confident, take hold of it.
Be confident, absolutely.
All right.
Back to the resume again. We've heard so many conflicting pieces of evidence about one page, more than one page.
Yeah.
If you've got credentials at the yin-yang, you can't fit it all on one page.
That's right.
Yeah. Should you try to anyway?
I think, you know, and this really, and the reason this is so conflicted is because it really depends on the HR manager, and it depends on the job, it depends on the profession, what sort of is the standard here. But the biggest thing is to remember, a padded resume looks padded, right? And so if you're just filling it full of stuff, people can tell that. If you legitimately have 2 pages worth of really great stuff, then do a 2-page resume.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
But really it's about self-editing and how much is just verbiage and how much really gives a snapshot. Remember, the resume is just a snapshot of you. It's just to get you in the door for an interview.
You want to show what really matters.
Mary, you want to show what really matters.
Thanks for sharing.
Thank you.